It's Saturday night, and I think that if you think Jesus Christ is wonderful, beautiful, glorious, and matchless, you should let him know. We got a little competition here this weekend because we got a Super Bowl, and I don't know about you, but I just don't know that Jesus Christ wants people cheering louder for a football team than him. So I'm going to give you one more chance. Come on now, let's hear it. Let's just pretend Jesus is out on that field tomorrow. How would you cheer for him then? What would that sound like? Yeah, sometimes. Yeah. You know what's really cool? It wouldn't even matter if you cheered; he'd win. He would definitely win. It's so good to see everybody here in church this weekend. Again, you made a really good choice to be here. I'm certainly glad that you've come. I know that there's a smile on our Savior's face. He's gone through a lot to get you here, and you made a good choice to honor that. And so I'm very, very excited. I'm sure he is as well. So thank you. Thank you so much for making this choice to be here. It's I want to take a minute to, I don't usually do this, but I just feel inclined to do so. I just want to take a moment, and I'd like to acknowledge that it's Mike DiGiacomo's birthday. Why don't you say happy birthday to him? Good to see him. And also, it's not only great to see a lot of new faces and people that I don't know, and I hope to meet you before you leave, but also really neat to see a lot of, I don't want to call it, that'd be bad to say old faces, right? I don't want to call you old, like that'd be terrible, but people we have not seen in a season, and they've decided for some odd reason, I don't know how God works, but a bunch of you have returned tonight, and so I'm so very thankful for that as well. Welcome back to the family. I just want to say that over the last 6 months or so, we have been studying through the Gospel of Luke because we're in the search of truth of who Jesus Christ is. We're in a new location. It's a new year. And really, we're kind of like a new church. Even though we've been around for a little while, it's all brand new. Everything that's in here is new. Most of you are new. Everything we do here is kind of new. It's just new, different. And we want to start out right by building a good foundation. We don't want to go on Google and find out who Jesus is. I'm really not concerned with what my grandmother told me he was. I don't care what my mommy said or my daddy or even what Billy Graham might have said. You got the Word of God right there at your disposal. And so what we've been doing is we've been searching through the Gospel of Luke so we could find out who Jesus Christ really is, what he really taught, what he really did, what he said he's going to do, who he says he is. Right? And who we are in him. We're looking for some truth because when we have truth, we can worship him in a mighty spirit. We can get fired up about someone we know. We don't want to worship someone we don't know. I want to know who he is so I can worship him well. And that's what we've been doing. So I don't want to veer from that. But I'll let you into a little bit of my world for the week. So what happens is last weekend's over, and so I get back into the scriptures, and I'm looking at the next thing, right, in Luke. That's what I'm supposed to do. So I'm in there, and I'm reading it over and over and over again, which is good, right? Nothing, right? It's like the coolest stories, and I got nothing to talk about, which is kind of weird for me, right? Nothing to talk about, but I got nothing. And so let me just let you in that usually when that happens, it's because God wants a detour. I find that to be the case, that he wants to detour to something different. And I'll tell you why I know that that's what it is that when I go back to it after a week or two, that same story that I read 25 times that did nothing, it's like, boom. He just wanted to take an in-course, a little detour, right? That's where we're at. That's where we're at with this week. So I don't know when we're going to get back to Luke. I'm planning for next week, but how many people have made plans? Right. Okay, so this week, we're going to be somewhere else. Go ahead and grab a copy of God's Word. They're all over the place. Don't cheat yourself. Don't just listen to me because I have a microphone on. You have Bibles that are in the seat backs in front of you in those pews. They're on the tables. They're everywhere. If you have your own, that's awesome. If you have a device, you can go ahead and use that. Open up your Bible app, and you can put your eyes on God's Word, right? Put your eyes on God's Word. And what I often will ask, I'm going to ask you again right now, because we're not here. We're here for quality of discipling. Like, I don't particularly care. I'm excited that there's a lot of people. That's great. But I'm not super, super excited about a lot of people if they're not a lot of people that are growing in Christ. And so I ask you this, if I could just kind of get you to look over here for a second. Does God have your attention, your full attention? If he doesn't, being here won't help. So let's put the Facebook down, the Instagram, the Snapchat, the Scattergories, the whatever it is we want to do. Let's get that away. Let's get our Bibles out. Let's get our notebooks out. Let's get our pens in hand. Let's take some notes. And so we can go back and we can check exactly what I told you this evening. It's so very, very, very important that you do that. So much tonight, I can't tell you. Most often, when I come in here, I'm pretty fired up about Jesus, right? I don't know if I'm the only one in here. I think there's a couple of you out there, right? Maybe, yeah. There's a couple out there. Next time I ask, I'd like to see a lot more of that. So I'm just pushing for that, right? But I want you to get fired up. I'm fired up about Jesus. I want you to get fired up about Jesus, and that's why we're here. We're here to get fired up about Jesus, but I don't want to always just be here kind of hoorahing you. We want to learn some truth. It's super important that you understand the truth, because if you're worshiping something that's not real, if you have a faith that's not really biblical, then it's really not going to get you anywhere. I don't want you to ever walk out of here, even if you've spent years here, I don't want you to ever walk out assuming that you have a Christianity that saves and someday you're going to be in glory when, in fact, it won't be. I love you too much to teach you something or have you get out of here without knowing the truth. I don't want to have that on me. There's a day, I don't know if you ever read it, in the Bible it says that I'm accountable for that. Like, he's going to look at me, I'm going to look at God, and he's going to say, what'd you do with those people that were there? I'm not looking forward to that day. I'm just being honest with you. Like, I want to tell you the truth, but I'm not looking forward to that day because I know that I'm going to make mistakes because I'm a man. But I want to make sure that you walk out of here. If you're sitting under this teaching ministry, I want you to know truth. That's super, super important to me. And I know it's super, super important to God. And I know in increasing measure, it's super, super important to our population. We want to know the truth. And so I want to share that. I want to chase that thing down tonight, okay? I want to open up by saying that there's a verse in Scripture that really scares me. And it kind of brought to my attention what we needed to do tonight. And because I love you, and I don't want you to walk out with some false sense of a faith that won't get you anywhere, there's a verse that kind of brings that right to the surface. And it's found in Matthew 7. And it just simply says something like this. It's a paraphrase, but it says that the highway, listen, depending on what Bible you read, the highway to hell, the road that everyone's taken, is wide. And most people are going there. But Jesus said that there's a narrow road that leads to life. And listen, this is the part that's scary. Very few find it. See, that should put a little bit of a holy fear inside of you. That you need to find out the truth, right? You need to know the truth, and that's what this night is about. I want you to walk out of here knowing truth, because I really desperately want you to find the narrow road that leads to life. It's super, super important, man. And so that's what I want to talk about tonight. We talk about, when we're in church, we talk a lot about being saved. And that idea of a narrow road and finding life. That's this idea in the church, in our faith. We call it being saved, right? Anyone ever heard of that? Get saved, be saved, get saved, I'm saved. Okay? So I want to talk about that a little bit tonight. You know, there's two things I want to mention about saved. First of all, to be saved. Maybe you never really thought about that. What does that really mean? Well, to be saved is to be free, to be liberated, to be delivered. I like this, to be bailed out. Don't raise your hand if you had to be saved in that way. To be rescued, right? To be rescued. That's to be saved. Well then, okay, to be saved is those things. I want to be free. I want to be liberated. I want to be bailed out. I want to be delivered. I want to be rescued. But how do I get saved? Well, you have to realize that you're personally unable to rescue yourself. There's no part in the word saved that it would ever include you. You have to understand that in your situation, when it comes to being saved, in any situation, to be saved from anything means that there's nothing you can do. And so your situation would require that someone outside of yourself would act upon you on your behalf. That's what being saved is. You have to realize that that's what it is. I want to show you what I'm talking about. When I'm talking about being saved and being completely unable to help yourself, it's something like that. It's the car on the cliff that's just teetering on the edge. And somehow you've tried to get out through the back and you're hanging on to the axle and there's no one around and there's nothing around you but death. And there's nowhere to go because if you move, what happens? The car crashes upon you. There's nothing. You see that guy? There's nothing he can do. The next one is a picture of people that are capsized on a boat. Out in the middle of the ocean, the boat is flipped over. There hundreds of miles all around. You do a 360 all around. There's nothing that you can see except a straight line. And there's nothing you can do in this situation to save yourself. Or perhaps this next one's a better illustration. Maybe you're in a building 20, 30, 40 stories high, and it's engulfed with flames. From the ground up, there's nothing below you. There's no way to get, the elevators aren't working, the staircases are filled with fire, there's nothing you can do, and you're trapped up on top. I am completely beyond help. There's nothing I can do to save myself. And when it comes to your life now, if maybe you weren't in a boat, capsized, maybe you've never been hanging off the edge of a cliff in a car or engulfed in a building and no way out, no way to rescue yourself. But there's another save, there's a problem. It's just as bad as that right there. It's sin. And every single person on earth has this problem. Every single one of us were birthed into sin from the moment of our conception. We're guilty passively. We didn't ask for it, but that's what we got. We're birthed into it. But we're also in active rebellion as we live. Every single one of us, myself, my beautiful daughter, her dear friend, and everyone around this room, every single one of us, if you're going to be honest, you know you're with sin. Everybody's guilty, right? Every single person. The Bible would say that all have turned. No one is seeking God. No one does good. No one is righteous. Romans 3:19 would go on to say that the entire world is guilty before a holy and perfect God. It's a universal indictment against all mankind. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what country, what color, what age. It doesn't make any difference. Everyone is guilty before a perfect and holy God. Well, I want to fix that problem. I don't want to be guilty before God. Do you guys want to be guilty before God? I don't want to be guilty. Right? Well, the Bible goes on the very next verse. It says that no one can ever be made right with God by doing what his law commands. So he gives us this commands. It tells us how we should live. But even if you do them real well, he says, hey, do them, but that's not going to make you right with me. So I got a problem. The Bible would take it a step down on the ladder to its lowest rung. And it would say in Ephesians 2:1 that you are actually dead in sin. You're completely helpless. You're hanging off the cliff. You're in the ocean. You're on the building, and there's nothing you can do to save yourself. This is harsh but true from a destiny of eternal torment in hell. That's just the way it is. If you don't like that, I get it, because I don't either. But I didn't speak the planets into existence. Christ did, and that's his rule. We have to live by it. I don't like it as much as you do. So we have a massive problem that I can't personally fix. I can't rescue myself. My situation requires someone outside of me to act upon me and help me. And of course, in sin's case, you're dead, which means you're completely helpless. Listen, you need a savior. I need a savior. Everyone needs a savior. The wages of sin is death. That means if you were a passive recipient of your sin nature when you were born, or whether you acted in sin as a person, as a child or a teenager or as an adult, anything. If you're acting in sin, the payment for what you've done is death. I don't like it, but it's true. Look at your neighbor and say, but. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus the Lord. Awesome. Awesome. Listen, the free gift. So we talked about saved, right? That's a church word. Hopefully you've got some clarity there. But here's another church word, grace. Yeah, what the heck is that? I just told you what it is. It's you are naughty, naughty little people. But the free gift, that's grace. You don't deserve it. You didn't earn it. You didn't even want it, and he gave it to you anyway. That's grace. And so let's talk a little bit about that grace tonight, okay? Do me a favor and turn to Galatians chapter 5. I hope that it continues to be your favorite tonight, not because of what you thought it said, but because God gives you new eyes to see some real truth that will bless you tonight. I do. Galatians chapter 5, I want to read just the first, I think, four verses, real simple. I don't want to go quickly. I want to make sure you're there. I want you to really get something out of this tonight. I want you to walk out of here just filled with some truth. You know what I'm shooting for? Let me tell you what I'm shooting for. Pull the curtain away a little bit. We're going to sing a song at the end. And the Bible, Jesus said that the Father's looking for those who would worship him in spirit and truth. So we're going to stockpile you with some truth. So when we get done, you can sing with some spirit. Yes. That's what we're looking for, okay? That's what we're looking for. So are you guys there? Yeah. Okay, Galatians chapter 5. Okay, he's writing to Christians. He's writing to Christians. And so if you're a Christian here tonight, he's writing to you. So Christ has truly set us free. That's saved, right? Talking about a minute ago, saving, being saved is to be free, delivered, rescued, right? So he's talking to the Christians and he says, so Christ has truly set us free. Talking about himself and the people that he's speaking to. We know that Paul was saved. So he must mean that they're saved, right? He has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free. And don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. Listen, exclamation point. See, I didn't get that whole idea of does God have your full attention? That wasn't original. Paul did it right there. Listen, I, Paul, tell you this. If you're counting on circumcision to make you right with God, then Christ will be of no benefit to you. I'll say it again, if you're trying to find favor with God by being circumcised, you must obey every regulation in the whole law of Moses. For if you're trying to make yourself right with God by keeping the law, you've been cut off from Christ. Exclamation point. You have fallen away from God's grace. You know what? He just said the same thing three times over and over again, right? I say again. Why? For the same reason he started out the paragraph, listen up, man. This is super important. This is super important what he's saying here. And that's what I'm trying to convey this message to you tonight the best way that I can, that this life and death are in the balance of this message right here tonight, that what's in this text, and you got to get a hold of it. You got to understand this stuff, okay? It's super, super important. I shared with you a few weeks ago about my Bible verse in Colossians 2:7, that I tend to steal, I try to steal a little bit of Jesus' thunder when it comes to building his church. You know, he says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, right? And I'm like, all right, Jesus, you got Germany and you got England and you got Australia, Hillsong's rocking, and you got LA and New York and you got over there and you got over there, but over here, Revolution Church, like I'll kind of take care of this, right? If I just really work really hard and I preach really passionately and the band's really good and we get comfortable seats, we'll build this thing over here, but you got the rest of it. I understand that you build your church, but I'll take care of this church. I mean, I'm just kind of guilty of that at times. I've had to do some repenting. But I learned once again that the foundation of the church is built on the apostles and the prophets, and that Christ Jesus is the cornerstone himself. Amen. Like, he don't need my help. Himself is like the major word there. That the weight of building Jesus Christ's church rests exclusively on the shoulders of Jesus Christ. Not me, not you, not you, or anybody else. If we didn't exist, his church would rule. That's a bet. No. Come on now. If you didn't see, that's taking yourself out of the equation. That's not easy to do, right? If you never even lived, his church would go on. Oh, amen. Right? You don't need anybody to help. So the weight of the church, the responsibility of the building of the church rests exclusively on Jesus. And likewise, salvation, like it says here, being made right with God, being in the family of God, being a son and daughter of God, being in God's good graces, finding favor with God, just being right with God, that has nothing to do with you either. That rests exclusively also on Jesus Christ the Lord. Ephesians 2:8 would say that God saved you by his grace. That it's a gift. It says that. That, listen, did you save you? No. God saved you by his grace, i.e., his gift. That's what he gave you. Your salvation has absolutely nothing to do with what you do. Nothing at all. No amount of law keeping or do-gooding gets it done. It's a gift. You're unable to rescue yourself by your actions or your thoughts or your deeds. Nothing you do can rescue yourself. And so, praise God, God intervenes in that situation and he inserts himself in the form of his son to save you because you can't save yourself. He rescues you from the top of the building. He goes out to the ocean and turns your boat back over. He rescues you, puts his hand out and grabs you off the cliff and saves you from yourself and your sin. Awesome, awesome Savior, right? You're saved. I think we have reason to celebrate for that. It's awesome, right? Anybody in here saved? It's awesome. That's incredible. Listen, you got to understand the weight of what happened. You could do nothing to help yourself. We're Americans. We're Americans, right? We build stuff and we smash stuff and we're proud and we could get stuff. We're the get her done country, right? Right? I don't know if you like this new dude or not. I don't care. You don't have to say nothing. But he's like, America, 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 we're going to do some awesome stuff. And even if you're not for him, you're like, you're dang right, America, right? That's the kind of people we are. But listen, in this case, no hoorah would help. Helpless. Nothing you can do to save yourself, and God intervenes and saves you. That's awesome. That's awesome. That's awesome. So here's the thing. Like, if you've ever done any evangelizing, you've shared your faith with somebody, and I encourage you to do so. It takes all of us to do that, by the way. Side note, his great commission is, hey, preacher, go tell everyone about me. He told his preachers, his holy nation of priests, which is you, to go tell everyone. Like, I can't get it all done. I get a big mouth, but I can't carry this thing around with me outside. I need your mouth. So we all have to do it. Lost my train of thought. But you ask these people, you know, are you going to go to heaven? And most of them will say, well, you know, yeah, I mean, yeah, I hope so. I think so. I'm good guy. And I do good stuff and I'm better than my Uncle John and he's just wretched and I only got drunk 4 times this week, so I'm good. You know, but like I do this and I give and I'm right. And so they kinda hope and everything. Listen, and if you're like a do-gooder, that's awesome. And I want to encourage you to do good. And to the circle of influence around you, to the people you impact on a day-to-day basis, if you do good, they're blessed, and that's good. Like even if you don't believe in God, if you're doing good, that's a blessing to people. It's good. It's really, really good. And I'd like to say that I'm proud of you. I think that's good. Yeah, but in this case of salvation, it's just meaningless. It doesn't really do anything. I mean, this is just the truth. I don't want to sugarcoat anything for you, right? I don't want that. The deal is you can do good all day, but it doesn't mean anything when it comes to salvation. Salvation is a gift. You can't rescue yourself no matter what you do. God rescued you. That's awesome, right? We have a reason to celebrate. It's a grace. But this text, here in Galatians chapter 5, I want you to see it clearly. Remember I told you, look at Scripture with fresh eyes. Learn, don't just assume, don't breeze by it. Learn something. When you read this text right here, he's not talking to the people that are pre-salvation, you know, hoping that their stuff that they do will get them in. This text right here says that it's written to Christians. It's, hey, Christ has set us free, including himself in that. He's like, no, this is a post-salvation text. This is written to people who are already saved. And it's talking about that we've been set free. But it also says that we could fall away from this grace. Let me just tell you something. You can't fall away from a place you've never been to. Are you following me? And it says that you can be cut off from Christ. Now, we're going to talk about some stuff tonight, and I want you, this is the deal. I desperately want you to open your Bible and look. I want you to take notes because this is huge. And I've kind of avoided this subject a little bit over the years, but I'm going to take it on head on tonight. But I don't want you to just assume that the preacher is right. There's preachers all over the world that think that they're right. And it's ultimately up to you to make a choice based on what God's word says. Take some notes, check it, make a choice. Amen? Okay. So here's the thing. It says that you could fall away from God's grace. You could be cut off from Christ. Now, this idea of being cut off from Christ, There's a couple times in the Bible that God will use imagery of a plant to describe his position and his relationship to you and his family and his church. And he uses in John chapter 15, he uses a vine, okay? He uses a vine. And I'm going to read something to you. In John chapter 15, he uses the vine. In Romans 11, he uses a tree. But listen here, remember, we're talking about cut off from Christ. What does this mean to be cut off from Christ? I'm a Christian, right? Written to Christians. Jesus Christ, in red, full attention should be given. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father in heaven, unseen God, is the gardener. Okay, now I want you to read with imagination. See this thing. He cuts off every branch of mine. What does that mean? Mine. Is that a non-saved person? No. Christ has set us free. I'm saved. And it says that he's the vine, the Father's the gardener, and that the Father cuts off every branch of mine. I've been bought at a price. I'm no longer mine, but Christ Jesus. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit. Now, he goes on, he says he prunes the branches back, you know, that do bear fruit, that are acting a little bit more like Jesus as time goes on. Like he's pruning that. We got some situations that in our life. Those are the pruning shears, right? Things that hurt a little bit, but we still grow, right? We cut off the blooms of the flowers, and it grows more. That's what he's talking about here. Some of us have some experiences, don't we? Very painful, but we learn from them. He says, you have already been pruned and purified by the message I've given you. See, he's talking to Christians now, right? And then he says this, remain in me, and I will remain in you. I got to ask you just a simple question, and we'll continue reading. If the option as a Christian has been removed from you to exit, why would he tell you to remain? For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. These are harsh words. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me, who's a big qualifier, isn't it? Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me, that means I was there, but then I left, right? Am I making this up? Is it right there? Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. Now, you got some imagery there, and I'm sure you can figure out what he's referring to. Doesn't take a brain surgeon here. Okay? Cut off from Christ. How about Romans chapter 11? You don't even have to go there. Romans chapter 11, he doesn't talk about a vine, he talks about a tree. And it's the same thing, same, very, very similar language. It says that believers, those who believe, are in the tree, and those who turn from believing, he's talking about Jewish people that were absolutely in. But when he came and declared himself in the person of Jesus Christ, they didn't believe God, and so it says God took them off the tree. But it also says, this is the encouraging news, it also says that when that unbeliever turns from their unbelief, he will graft them back in. By no means will Jesus Christ deny anyone who comes to him. No matter how many times you ask, no matter how many things you've done, no matter how far away you've gotten, if you turn from your sin and run at Jesus, his arms are wide open to receive you. He cannot deny himself and he cannot lie. He said he will never deny anyone who turns and comes to him. That's awesome news. But there's some scary news there, right? I'm not making this up. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anybody is in, there's that word again, in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has died. Behold, the new man. It's a new person. When you're in Christ, you're a new person. But I need you to know the truth. What does the truth do? Sets you free. Colossians chapter 1, verse 23. I'm just going to read this to you. But you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. Man, that's scary to me. And that takes an axe to the base of the theology that I was brought into Christ's body in. That told me that I have an assurance of salvation because I said yes to him one time. That there's an assurance, and the Bible says, don't drift away from the assurance that you heard, that you got when you first got saved. And it's speaking right to me, and I'm like, whoa, what are you saying? That the assurance is only valid if I continue to believe it. That's what it says. Hebrews chapter 3. Verses 12 and 14, 12 through 14. Be careful then, brothers and sisters. He's not talking to strangers, right? He's talking to you. If you're a Christ follower, he's talking to you. Be careful, Christian. Be careful to the one who gave his heart to the Lord. Be careful. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving. Whoa. That rocks the boat right there, right? Wait a minute, I'm in. Wait, it says right here, be careful then, Christian. Make sure your hearts aren't evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. You must warn each other every day. That's what I'm doing here tonight because I love you. While it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. For if, say if. For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly as when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. Amen. Dude, it doesn't get any clearer than that. And this is all through Scripture, man. I'm going to give you more. You want more? Hebrews chapter 10, verse 37. Just digging out truth, man. That's it. I think I got this right. 10, 37 through 39. Oh. For in just a little while, the coming one, that's Jesus, will come and not delay, and my righteous ones will live by faith, but I will take no pleasure in anyone who turns away. Listen, the Bible says in Romans, I think I may have shared it, that no one is righteous, not even one, right? None of you are righteous. The only way you're righteous is because Jesus is righteous and you accepted who he is and his spirit's living in you. So it's his righteousness that makes you righteous before God, right? So if you're righteous in any way, it's only because of Jesus. You have to be a Christian that he's talking to. And he says he takes no pleasure in one who is a Christian and turns away. But we are not like those who turn away from God to their own destruction. No, we are the faithful ones whose souls will be saved. I pray that's you. I pray that that is you tonight. I pray that that is you tonight. I got more. 2 Timothy 2:12. Just says this, if we endure, we will reign with him. Some teaching out there will tell you that if you're really a Christian, you'll endure to the end. When I don't know about you, but it is written that if you do endure to the end, then you'll be a Christian. I mean, I just read it, right? It just says, it doesn't say if you're a Christian, you'll endure. If you're a Christian, you'll keep believing. It says, no, if you keep believing and then you endure, then you can come in. Then you can reign with me. Then you can receive all that inheritance that I have waiting for you. I got one more. 1 John chapter 2, 24, 25. So you must remain faithful to what you have been taught from the beginning. If you do, that's a qualifier too, right? If you do this, if you remain faithful to what you were taught. Someone shared the gospel with you that you were a sinner in need of a Savior and you said yes to that and you received Christ as your Lord and Savior. All right, that's awesome. But it says here that if you remain faithful to that, if you do, you will remain in fellowship with the Son, Jesus Christ, and with the unseen Father. And in this fellowship, not in any other fellowship, in that fellowship alone, you will enjoy the eternal life he promises us. That's it. I think it's quite clear here about something. And I plead with you to take the time during this week and research what I've shared with you. Because eternity is in the balance. And I believe with all my heart that you can't come forward when the preacher says come and say I give my life to Christ and not continue to believe this thing. And to not continue to trust Christ throughout the whole journey of life to the very end, to your last breath, your last moment. If you're not doing that, that's why he says that the road is narrow and only a few find it. Right here, man. This should put a holy scare in you. Saved people are in the vine. They're in the tree. They're in the grace. They're in Christ. But it's unbelief. Not that you just sin, because we all fail in many ways, but unbelief causes God the Father to cut you off the vine, to cut you off the tree, to fall away from the grace that was given. And our text is teaching us here that if you're in, but you try to do good or keep God's word to somehow increase position or amplify God's pleasure in you or to make him love you a little bit more because of what you've done, you're taking a sledgehammer to the foundation of your salvation. God's word speaks clearly to this in James chapter 2, verse 17, where it talks about faith producing good deeds. Nowhere in there does it say that good deeds produce faith. It doesn't work that way. Some of you are falling away. I need you to pay attention here now. Pay attention. It says that if you're doing this, if you're trying to change your position or enhance your position with God by what you do, then listen, this is scary. Then Christ will be of no benefit to you. We mentioned last week that God was in Christ. He was already God. Christ was God way before he came in the manger. So the only reason why he actually came down here was to seek and save that which was lost, to benefit you in some way, because you were in sin and you were dead in your sin and you needed someone to rescue you. And so he went to the cross to pay for that. And what this is saying is if you try to enhance that some way and add to it in some capacity, that what Christ did on the cross is no benefit to you. The Christ that at one point did everything for me is no longer important or pertinent in my life. No benefit from Christ. You're cut off, it says, from Christ. So the first point I wanted to make was that your salvation, your position eternally with God cannot be purchased. And it can't be maintained by purchasing maintenance plans. It's not transactional. That if somehow I do this, God will do that. He said, it is finished. It is finished. Your simple belief in that is all you need to be holy, blameless, and without a single fault before the Father right now and for all eternity. Can I get an amen? Amen. It's true. It's true. So if I don't have to do something to keep him happy with me and find favor with him, why in the world am I like, you know, the open and read it, do it thing that we got around here? Like, why would I do that? Why would I keep God's word? Why would I obey? Well, we don't purchase our position, but we are positioned for purpose. Okay? We're positioned for purpose. This is the why of salvation. Why did God save you? Well, of course, John 3:16, everybody knows that. Why? Because he loves you. He came down, stepped off of his throne. I'm God of gods, and I step off my throne. I become a slave, and I wash people's feet, and I'm whipped and beaten when I didn't need to save you. Why did he do that? For you. Out of love, but there was a reason for it. There's some practical application. Why did he save you? I kind of just jotted down three things. You could jot these down. Here's the first one. It's to be with you. It's to be with you. You know, God created us in his image to be like him. And remember the story of Adam and Eve? They're roaming around in the garden, right? Running around naked. Everyone's having a good time. God's hanging out with them face to face, person to person. That's a good time. And then sin, and it fractures the cosmos. And all of a sudden, we're separated. And God's here, and we're down here. And there's a separation. The New Testament would tell us in Colossians 1:21 that you were far from God, that you were separated from him. That's the problem. So he comes and he saves us. Why? So we can close the chasm. Revelation 21:3. Let me just read this to you. It's just totally awesome. We're going to Revelation. Someone say, ooh. Yeah. It's not that scary, guys. 21:3 says this. I heard a loud shout from the throne. You guys want to do that? Just for fun? You want to practice it? I heard a loud shout from the throne. That was close. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. That's like awesome, right? So what he's trying to do in Christ when he saves you is to restore that thing that he had with Adam and Eve when he's walking face to face right in your very presence. That's what he wants. That's why he saved you. And that explains Hebrews 12:2, where it says that Jesus For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Was going to the cross fun? Did it feel good? Did that make his day? No, he was whipped, beaten, stripped, spit, stretched, and killed. But there was joy there. What's the joy? Revelation 21:3, that someday that he'll look past all that he has to go through so he could be with you. That's why he saved you. So he could be with you. The joy set before him is Revelation 21:3, that he will be with you and you will be with him face to face. Amen. So he did it to be with you. He did it also to use you, right? To use you. 2 Corinthians 5:17, that anyone who's in Christ, he's a new creation. Thank you. That if he's a new creation, the old has died, and behold, a new man. And it goes on and says, it's a gift. There it is again, God's grace showing up again in your life. And it goes on to say in the next couple of verses, it says that it's a gift. And now here's the gift. You ready? Not just that you were saved, but here's the gift. That God is now going to use you as agents of reconciliation, that Christ came down reconciling people to God, and now he's given you the wonderful message to do the same, and God is using you to make his plea to the lost world. It takes every single one of us for God to accomplish his kingdom coming. That's the job. He wants you to be his mouthpiece. He wants you to be his agent, his ambassador. That's why he saved you, to use you to spread the good news to the world. So he saved us to be with us. He saved us to use us. And here's the most important thing for us. He saved us to do good. Ephesians 2:10. This is awesome. It says, we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Listen. I want to tell you the truth. He's not speaking to everybody. There's a little bit of a caveat there you got to remember. You got to see it, notice it. See, I could get up here and say, all of us, see, you're his masterpiece. No, Christians are his masterpiece. Because he says he's created us anew. What's amazing is if you stop there, thinking about masterpiece, a couple weeks ago, we did this brush it off paint night. Anyone here for that? Yeah. It was fun, right? Yeah. Some good works. Great stuff, right? It was beautiful. I went online. I started looking up masterpieces online. Started looking up paintings. There's some that are worth, I saw one, the most expensive painting in the world. It's worth $252 million. I wouldn't give them 10 bucks for that thing. Honest to goodness. I went to the top 20. I wouldn't give 10 bucks for all of them combined. They all look stupid. It looks like a kid with a stinking crayon. Oh, that thing's worth $95 million. Really? What was wrong with Picasso? That guy must have been hammered every time he painted. He got eyeballs going over here. Oh, $92 million. Really? Do you know what didn't even make the list? The Mona Lisa. You know why? There's no price. I started thinking about that there's amazing works of art all across the world over time, right? And then there's this one, this Mona Lisa, that just head and shoulders above all the rest, right? It's a masterpiece. Precious. Immeasurable. Unmatched. I started thinking about this. Does anyone know how many species of life there are on this earth? Just on this earth. 1.731 million species. Did you ever see a bald eagle? They're awesome. What's your favorite animal? What's your favorite animal? Do you have a favorite animal? No? Who? Anyone? A dolphin? The way they swim, they just cut through that water like it's warm butter, man. So, I mean, what else? A tiger, the ultimate killer, right? Just incredible. The colors and the way they hunt down their prey. What else? What? Sheep? A sheep? Really? Awesome. I'm not even prepared for that, so good one. Anyone else have anything that's awesome? Huh? Oh, please. Kyle's Rottweiler. When you think of all the incredible animals and life forms out there, when you think of the expanse of the Rocky Mountains and you look at them, and when you look at every single day, no matter where you are in this country, you see these beautiful, not my country, this world, these incredible sunsets. I get them across the street from my house every night, and you're like, wow, that's amazing. All these incredible, beautiful, amazing things that have been created. And in all of creation, God says that this wretched thing that was totally unable to help itself, filled with sin, that I somehow helped and made him anew in Christ, that is his ultimate masterpiece. You are the Mona Lisa of all creation. That's insane. That's amazing to me. Amazing to me. You have worth. But listen, when you're in, it's to do good. It's to do good things. It's to tell as his mouthpiece, to tell of the good news so that God can be with his masterpiece for all eternity. That's why you're saved. That's the purpose of your salvation. Good deeds are the purpose of your position, not to purchase it. And third and last thing, good deeds and obeying God's word are not to purchase position, but for the purpose and this proof of position. I love easy scripture verses that I don't have to look up or nothing, you know? Real simple ones. How about this one? James 2:18. I will show you my faith by my good deeds. Right? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. My good deeds will not earn my faith. It will not create my faith. Because I have faith that God has given me anyway, I will do good as a result of that, to show that I have it. Now, here's the last one here. 1 John 3:7-10. Dear children, don't let anyone deceive you about this. You see this, the loving, endearing words of John speaking to his people that he loves, and I'm speaking to you right now that I love you. Listen, don't let anyone deceive you. I want you to hear this clearly, what God's word is going to speak to you about, okay? Because eternity is in the balance. Dear children, don't let anyone deceive you about this. When people do what is right, it doesn't earn, it shows that they are righteous even as Christ is righteous, right? Remember, none of us are righteous. No one is righteous. No one is good. No one's looking to God. No one's being right. But if you've accepted Christ, he is righteous. And so it says here, if you do good, it's only because Christ is righteous and he's living in you. It's the only reason why you're doing good. And it shows that that's who you are. Look at verse 10. So now we can tell who are children of God and who are children of the devil. Anyone who does not live righteously, and let's just pause there. If anyone is not allowing the Spirit of Christ that's in you to show himself, if you're not letting Christ live through you, if people can't see Jesus in you, not just a better form of Andy, but Andy's dead, Christ lives through him. If you're not doing that and you do not love other brothers and sisters in faith, you do not belong to God. These are stern words from the Lord. Very, very stern. I'm going to ask the band to return, please. I appreciate those who stayed and remained and want to be faithful to the Word of God and being taught the Word of God. We're almost done. Try to stay focused. Truly saved people, they obey God's word and they do good not to purchase their position, but it's the purpose of your position and the proof of your position, right? Yep. We clear? Okay. I want to take a few moments with you, family of God, to do something that's very, very precious, has been passed down through the ages as a gift to you and a way to honor the Lord who went to the cross for you. Amen. We're going to take a few minutes. We're going to take communion. Could I get three people, any three right now, to come up and just pass out these communion elements? And listen, as the elements are being passed out, I'm going to ask you to just hold on to them, and we're going to go ahead and take them together as a family. Your worship band is going to lead you here now in song. And when we get done with that song, we're going to go ahead and we're going to take communion together as a family. Amen? Amen? All right. So go ahead and hold on to those, and we'll come back with you in just a moment. We'll do this together.
One with God, the Lord Most High. Your glory hidden in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. And nothing could. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. Our sin was great, your love was greater. Nothing can separate us now. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. You are raised to life again. And you have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. And nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
So now we want to celebrate Jesus Christ's work on the cross, where our salvation was purchased. By the giving of his body and the shedding of his blood. And so, Lord Jesus, we thank you for that. But as often that we take this, I'm reminded that I'm to take it to remember you, but I'm also reminded how insufficient this must be to show appreciation for what you did on the cross, to eat a piece of cracker and drink a little cup, but it's what you want. That's what church is all about. It's about you, Lord. This is what you want. This is what we shall do. As we take a moment to reflect upon that amazing grace that saved a wretch like me. And so now, brothers and sisters in the Lord, let's celebrate what Jesus Christ has done on the cross by taking this bread to remember his sacrifice of his body on the cross for you and your sin. The wages of our sin is death. The free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus the Lord. So the price was paid by you shedding your blood, Lord Jesus. And we thank you for doing that. And to thank you, we take the cup now. Let's pray, Lord. We couldn't save or rescue ourselves. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for saving us. We thank you, Lord, for continuing to work and change us. And Lord, all of that is done on the cross. Nothing we need to do to enhance what you've already done. Or supplement it somehow. You said it is finished. Jesus, your work on the cross is sufficient. And I don't want to disregard what you did for me on that cross. So I declare by faith tonight that what you did for me is all I need to be in your family. Thank you, God. Help us, Lord, to find the narrow road that only a few find. In Jesus' name, amen.